I was the cream of hot coffee. And only people in Yazoo City's feelings got hurt about it because they thought I was ashamed of my birthplace, which was not true. But when I told the press agent that Yazoo City meant the city of death because it was an Indian name, because the Yazoo River came down and had malaria mosquitoes there, which bit the Indians and they all died, so they called it the Yazoo. And he said, oh, you can't do that. That's horrible. That's horrible. And he said, what are some other towns in Mississippi? And I said, well, there's Greenwood or Clarksdale. He said, no, that's not funny enough, not good. I said, there's Hushpuckanee. He said, no, that's too funny, not good. Well, there is a place called Hot Coffee. That's it. You are the cream of hot coffee. And so here I sit, the cream of hot coffee today. You know, I was always told at Catholic schools that I would have a vocation. And my vocation was not a religious one. I didn't become a nun. I went and became an actress, you know. And that was about the other end of the scale of what women could do back in those years. I had become a model, and I would converse with the people in the tea room where I was modeling junior sophisticates and was studying acting. And I got a chance to go to New York City, and I went there for 6 days and met the executives of 20th Century Fox, who said to me, you will be the girl to play Jean Harlow in our Jean Harlow movie, but we want you to come out to 20th Century Fox and test for contract. And so I did, and I got the contract, and I never played Jean Harlow. They had dropped me from contract. I later learned that the reason I was dropped is that it never showed that I had done one day of work. And all these 15-hour days I put in, I never got a penny of overtime. I just got my regular salary, you know. No one ever told me to punch in a clock, punch in and punch out. I was under contract. I was an actor. I wasn't going to do something like that. They did that in factories, you know. And I didn't think of a movie studio as a film factory. I thought of it as an artistic place to do my work, you know. Well, that was a little naive of me, I'm sure. And I happened to wave at the assistant director with whom I had worked on Say One for Me. And he was walking with Eddie Dimitrik, who was about to make the remake of The Blue Angel with Mai Britt and Kurt Jurgens. And so I got in that picture from waving hello. And while I was in costume for that, as I had told Kurt Jurgens in the picture that the clown had died in the act, and so he then becomes the clown. Well, the head of the studio saw that in the dailies and called me up to his office. And I had this bizarre green makeup, and I was in fishnet stockings and a very low-cut outfit, you know. And he asked me if I had ever been under contract anywhere. I said, yes, sir, you just dropped me 3 weeks ago from here. And so he said, my goodness, you're a really good actress. I'm going to look into it and see what we can do about it. I said, oh, thank you so much. I'd love to come back. But by that time, I went over to Paramount and met Norman Panama and Melvin Frank, who were doing the Broadway show Little Abner on film. And I was young and blonde and came from Memphis, and I wanted to play Daisy May, of course. And they looked at me and said, what do you look like with red hair? I said, a redhead. And they said, would you like to play a passion out of Unclimax, because Tina Louise will not do it. And I said, sure, I would love to. And I got to be a passion out of Unclimax, the mistress to the richest man in the world, General Bull Moose, and had some really funny lines, and got to catch Little Abner in the Sadie Hawkins Day race. That was big. Well, a passion out of Unclimax was the first starring role that I had, because I had some smaller roles. They were called featured roles. I thought that any exposure that I got as an actress in the right role would be good for me, and that has proven itself to be true. But what I really wanted to learn to do was something I didn't know. I had studied acting a little, and I knew a little bit about it, and you never know everything about it. Each person that you play is different. But I wanted to be a writer-director. I had majored in English and minored in history, and I wanted to learn, as I said, Frank Tashlin was my first director. He was a writer-director. And then when I worked with Jerry Lewis in The Nutty Professor, Bill Richmond had done the script, but Jerry, too, was writing. And I had this image of writer-directors, and that's what I wanted to do in movies, because I knew I was a good comedian, and I did not think of myself as a great dramatic actress, although I can do drama. I am not as entertained by it as I am my comedy. But I always had a knack for playing sexy comedy, and it was all tongue-in-cheek and funny punchlines and good timing. And it was not having a breast job and, you know, looking like a slut. That was not my thing, ever. So times change, and, you know, I never needed one, thank God, but, you know. Phil Feldman was, I believe, a good producer because he was brave enough to take on Sam Peckinpah and this story. He loved this story. He particularly loved this story. And he seemed to understand it. And I don't know if he was kidding me or if he was serious when he said to me that he didn't know if I was right for the role or not, or if I could come up to it or whatever. But later he gave me a lovely book at the end of the picture, and he said, you dispelled every fear I ever had, and I want you to know you did a wonderful job and you were fabulous in it. And he was a good producer. He was a good producer. And he knew that Sam was a crazy man, but he went ahead and did it anyway. Sam had so many people that knew he was kind of down and kind of out and kind of crazy, but we all said, I'll give you my support, Sam. I'll give you my support, Sam. I'll give you my support, Sam. And he took it and sucked it into himself and didn't give anything back much, and it didn't seem to matter. I didn't know very much about him at first. I had never heard of him, so I was not familiar with his work. Later on, I did see some of it that I really liked. People had told me about him, people who worshipped him and thought that he was a great, great filmmaker, and that he was like a great teacher or guru, and he was like a mystic. And then I met this person, and he was a kind of small guy, and he was in cowboy boots and Levi's and a cowboy hat. He dressed the part of a cowboy. He didn't dress the part of a director. Everybody spoke so highly of him. I expected a bigger presence. I knew he was supposed to be a great one and worshipped by people. And then I read the script. He always called the picture a comedy, but I saw it for a love story from the time I read it, first saw the things. I knew it was about the relationship between Jason and Hildy. And she was a very strong woman who wanted to go to San Francisco. She had her mind made up. And he was strong-minded and wanted to stay there where he found water where it wasn't. But they loved each other, and so they parted through most of all the time they could have spent together, and then when they finally do get back together, it doesn't work. So it's a tragic love story. And he kept saying, it's a comedy. And it had a lot of comedy in it to hide the fact that it was indeed a tragic love story. He said that he was going to write in that Hildy would return, and that was going to be a wonderful moment in the film when she came back. He didn't tell me he was going to kill Jason right after that, but it was a wonderful moment, and it needed to be there. And so I did tell him that I would take the picture, and I would do it. And I actually asked for a very wonderful costumer who had done The Royal Hunt of the Sun on Broadway, and he had never done a film, so he did that wonderful costume for me. He was fabulous, and that outfit was fabulous. It's like the desert coming to life and turning green. It's like in a desert of all pale colors, green is life, and so that's really good. I think symbolically it's better than red for her to come back, even though she was a hooker. She's made a lady of herself. Now she wears a green dress. So it seemed to work for the film, though. She certainly does expose her heart in the film, whereas Jason has a heart throughout it, but is a man who doesn't like to show it quite as much. Even in the scene where she tells him she's leaving, maybe he would want to cry, but he doesn't. And he had quite a bit of heart, and that's maybe what attracted them to each other, that they had true feelings for each other. And they knew it was important, and he wanted to go get her, but he was just too late. I did say him once to Sam, I said to him, well, I'm just trying to find out who Hildy is. And it was out in the open in the Western street, and he yelled at me, she's you, you know, like in such a way as to say, you're the whore, you know. He was not very nice. And he did that to men to rile him, too. There have been many men who have done things to get even with Sam because he had no tact. I thought it was coming out very well, especially the scenes with Jason and myself. He seemed to have a lot of respect for me, and he loved me, and I loved him. He used to call me Sarah Siddons. Do you know who that is? She was a very famous actress in Chicago. She did theater years and years ago, of that period, almost. And so he kidded me, but he was always gentle and sweet and kind. And, you know, I wondered why someone like Hildy, my greatest challenge was to figure out why she, who wanted to go to the wonderful town of San Francisco and have jewelry and clothing and high life and champagne and fancy dinners and wonderful shoes, why would she fall in love with this guy? Why? And the only reason I could think of and come into any way of doing it was that we never know why. It just happens upon us. And we actually love those people. And they get along with us and they love us. And, you know, if that happens, it's kind of a magic that is not explainable. So I just went with the belief that it's a magical thing. And since Jason and I never really had sex together, I said they must have the greatest sex life in the world, you know. And my imagination could probably go much farther than the reality. So it lasted forever, my admiration and love for him. I had seen him do Toys in the Attic in New York on stage. And I had just worshipped him as an actor. And I felt he was just, it was such a, to me, a great step upward to be working with great actors like this. You know? And so unusual for a great actor such as Jason to play in a Western like this. It's the only thing he's ever done like this. It's because they have fallen so deeply in love that he hurts her feelings with just a one-liner. He throws this line out, well, you know, I didn't charge you because you didn't mean charge me nothing, you know. And with that, her whole house of cards falls down, you know. And she realizes, wait a minute, you didn't come here to be with this bum. You got to go to San Francisco and marry the richest man in San Francisco. That's your goal. So you've got to go after it. But I don't want to. It hurts too bad. No, you have to go. Okay, I will, you know. And then she goes. But she does go get him that night for, you know, one more lovemaking time before she leaves. It's hard to turn the waterworks on and off and on and off and on and off without somebody blowing glycerin crystals in your eye, you know. So it was real, and it happened, and it was great because of Jason and because of David. Excellent. David is an excellent, excellent actor as well, and the two of them, and the challenge to make it so believable and to reveal that hurt, that he had hurt her very deeply. It was a good acting challenge to me, and I was scared to death, of course, but I couldn't let it show. And I think that gets the adrenaline up when you're so fearful that you're not gonna make your mark, you know, you keep raising the bar. And finally, it seemed to be just all right, and it was rather simple after all.
Butterfly morning. Butterfly mornings, butterfly mornings, and wildflower afternoons.
They sent us out with a pitch pipe to an arroyo in the middle of the desert with Nagra, you know, sound recorder, and we recorded it a cappella. And then Jerry Goldsmith came in later and put music to it. That was it. We never got a second chance to do anything. They didn't have pitch correction. They didn't have anything. We just sang it. We did it. They used it. That was it. It's lovely, isn't it? Yeah. That was not written by Jerry Goldsmith. Richard Gillis used to play in a bar close to the studio at, you know, on Riverside Drive near Warner Brothers. And he heard these songs, and they are so unique and so beautiful. And Sam, he does have good taste in music, I think, even in The Wild Bunch, you know. The Mexican song that he uses is so wonderful. But I don't think Richard Gillis ever got enough recognition or anything to inspire him to keep writing such beautiful things after this, because the picture was such a heartbreaking failure for everybody, you know, that we didn't even like to talk about it. It would just bring a, make us choke up, because it was such a waste. The attitude of the crew after being there, the ladies came on maybe after they had worked a week and a half or been out there in the desert by themselves. And so, you know, they were out there peeing on the rocks and spitting and talking and drinking and telling jokes and doing all that. And they resented it when the women came on. My stand-in Jane and my hairdresser, Kathy Blondell, and I went out there, and it was like, here come the women. God, we ain't gonna have any more fun, you know, that kind of. It was just grumbling. It would have been nicer if he didn't pose as he did and sit behind sunglasses that have mirrors on them so that no one could see his eyes. Because he was such a liar, he was afraid to get caught, because if you look in someone's eyes deeply enough, you can tell they're lying, you know. So he was afraid of that. He wouldn't let anybody see his eyes. His hatred, his loneliness, his whatever that he has, his angst, he could not let it go. He had to try to drown it in alcohol, but that's like pouring gasoline on a fire. But he wouldn't stop. And it was common sense that he should do that, so I'm not sure that he had common sense. He would make people mad and cause fights and then run hide, and he wouldn't be there. He would, you know, take a punch here or there, but he was not a fighter. He was a little bitty guy. You could deck him with one punch. I probably could have, you know. That's how he lived. And he only thought about himself. And if it wasn't going well for him in life, as it did not go well for him because of his bad behavior, he figured that people would pay attention to him after he died, and he wanted that. Sam Peckinpah took himself very seriously. You just mentioned the fact that when he was not working, he was in his minor hell because he didn't know what to do with himself. But he didn't play with his children. He didn't take them to ball games and go places with them and see them and have a time that they could remember a great father in their childhood. He didn't seem to care about anything but his own work. He would do anything to get it, but it was always something mean. He was really never kind, not kind to himself. He didn't want to be taught by anybody. He wanted to be the teacher. And he taught people mean lessons, and they hated him for all his life. Having the studio hate you so much, they'll flush the picture instead of releasing it. And everything he did that turned everybody against him. I hope in my life I don't have anybody who really hates me with all their heart. Anybody, not anyone. I hope that I've settled all my scores with people and that we're kind of even, Steven. I haven't done anything nasty and bad that I didn't ever apologize, you know. I don't want that hanging over me. When I saw the picture in the theater, I cried. I just thought, well, it's just not, they're not going to do it. It's not going to do it. It's not going to do it. And I've always loved actors because actors expose their naughty little secrets of who they are and how they are to other people, to let them see it for real without exposing it to themselves and feeling guilty or bad, and making them feel a little better. Well, God, if he's like that, maybe that's how I am too. And he worked it out. Maybe I can. You know, we learn by seeing, don't we? A lot. I realized how shallow the business is. And when I got to be 45 years old, I didn't think anybody would ever hire me again, you know. So now when they hire me, it's just gravy on a wonderful career I already have. Sam always said that directing was 90% casting. We had an agreement when I finally said, okay, yes, if she comes back, I will play Hildy in the Ballad of Cable Hogue, but you must promise me, and your hand on it, that we will do another picture together. You have to give me another film then. You're asking me to take half price, and then you're asking me, you're telling me she's going to come back. I guess she will. But, you know, if I do this for you, Sam, then you're going to have to do something for me. And so when the picture came up, I met with Sam. And yet, when Steve McQueen and I sat in a booth at lunch together, he said to me, I have to tell you one thing. I consider you competition. And I knew I wasn't going to get the picture, and I didn't. We never have any control over our work when we give it to film or digital. Other people have control of editing, and they have control of whether it's even used or not, you know. We don't have any control over that. And when you are a professional actor, that's what your work is. You go find another job. I have had so many disappointments in my life that they wash off me like rain on a duck's back. I cannot hold on to it. The pain is too heavy. I am the only person who has taken care of herself in her life. I have not been married. I don't have a rich husband. I have worked for almost everything I've done. And I have had worse situations than that. I'm at last going to get to do my heart's desire. That I have written films that I'm going to direct. And even if I'm not in them, I can at least be in the business I love and want to do what I've always wanted to do. But all of those challenges, they gave me that fear, that gave me the adrenaline to bring me up to the thing that I actually did it very well. I'm kind of proud of my work. That's probably why I'm talking to you now. I didn't have another film like this. I always love, I'm a sucker for love stories. This is, I did a bunch of comedy love stories, but this is the only really serious love story, I believe, that I have ever done. We were sitting in Tombstone, Arizona, last 4th of July, and they in a parking lot on a bench, and they started the fireworks. And four people sitting on another bench that had been out there in the parking lot of the Tombstone Motel. And we sat and we watched them for a while. And this guy said, hey, did you see that movie, Ballad of Cable Hogue? Oh, hell, that's Stella Stevens. When she jumps out of that water, whoo, never saw anything like that in my life. And the guy said, well, you better lower your voice. She's sitting right beside you over here. And the guy nearly died because I was. I said, hi there. We're just watching the watching the fireworks with you. That's all. So, but it did, you know, people do remember it. Some people remember me running naked. Other people remember me crying that I didn't want to have to leave. And other people remember my favorite thing, which is when I return and throw my hat away and run with my arms open into his arms. And that, for me, is the moment in the movie. She had to make the Ladiest Damn'd Lady you ever saw. And Jerry Goldsmith's music swells up with all of that. I mean, it's just, it's a heartbreaker. And then later when he dies, it breaks your heart again. But the picture's definitely a love story. I feel like it's really a good one.
Let tomorrow be the song you sing, and yesterday won't mean a thing. Make today your next day's dawn, and you'll still be here grinning when today's all gone. And tomorrow's still the song I sing, good or bad. whatever it brings. Got no choice, greet the day, and whatever debt I owe to fate, I'll make fate pay.